Hey, we did
We did it. Oh my God. How's it going?
This makes me feel old sometimes.
Honestly, I don't even know how to do half the things. Like, TikTok has taken me so long to try and figure out.
You have any good ones yet? Have you done any yet?
No. I've done like a couple, but I feel like I'm going to be one of those really awkward people. So I have to like practice first, you know?
Yeah,
Are you on TikTok?
I have two where it's just my friends telling me not to do TikTok.
It's gonna be bad.
Okay, wait. I gotta play my theme song. Otherwise, there's an order for this show.
Okay, yeah.
Here There we go. That took me way too long. So how are you? How's your quarantine?
I'm good. Yeah, I mean,
Where are you?
I'm in Montreal right now.
Okay. I feel like you're always in like between three places, so I'm never 100% sure where you are. Am I wrong? Or are
Exactly,
you
yeah.
mostly Montreal?
I've been in Toronto for like most of my quarantine period, and then I came back 2 days ago here to
Okay.
Montreal, which is where I'm based out of. But I had a couple of things I wanted to finish in Toronto, so I'm here
Nice.
now.
Like musical things.
Yes. Some new stuff coming out soon, so I just wanted to polish it up and call it done. And then I'm writing a bunch of new stuff here in Montreal, so
Do you know
yeah.
when it'll come out?
I do, yes.
Can
And
you
I
tell
guess I
us?
can say it here. I can say it here first. But yeah, there's a new song coming out April 17th.
Oh, like soon. Damn, it's exciting.
Yeah, I'm stoked. How are you?
What's the song called?
The song is called Bad Times Are Good Times.
Bad times are, sorry, what?
Bad Times Are Good Times.
Ah, I like that. That's like a good quarantine anthem.
Yeah, I wrote it real quick, because of the whole quarantine situation, and like, yeah, I'm writing a whole other new record, but I'm trying to do like just a few songs right now because it's like all my feelings are so invested in what's going on right now that I can't really seem to write about anything else. So I need to get it out of my system, to move
Yeah.
on
Do
to
you
what I
feel,
was working.
are you feeling still really creative during this, or do you find it making it harder for you?
I'm feeling like really creative personally, which is so, I feel so lucky to feel that.
Yeah.
What about you?
I'm kind of like, it's sort of day to day for me. Like some days I'll just do it totally normally, and then other days, I don't know. I just feel, I feel, I think I'm a little bit uninspired sometimes because I don't like know when my next show is, and sometimes like the idea of like performing it live is like a big inspiration to me. So it's a little bit stressful, but obviously it's gonna pass. So it's kind of, I need to just get over that and just keep writing like it normally is, I think.
Because you would do a lot of shows, right? Like you were performing pretty regularly.
Yeah, I was supposed to go to Miami like right when this was happening, and I had like six shows that week for Miami Music Week, so it was kind of shitty, but
I'm so
it's all
sorry.
good. Everyone's in the same boat, so no apologies necessary. So I'm gonna ask. I got some questions for you. The talk show. We're on the talk show. Okay, so I really like the artwork for your Tamale album. How did that come about?
So I brought on these two guys from, same, cheers.
Yes.
So there's kind of like this duo, and they're called Will Studios, and their names are Eric and Raul, and I brought them on for creative direction
Cool.
for Tamale. Yeah, and they knew this artist named Yishan, or his name is Yishan Lee. And we kind of brainstormed the single artwork, and the album cover actually came last. So the single artwork was developed, and then I was really inspired. I've always been really inspired by Frida Kahlo, and kind of wanted to do like a spin-off on different symbolism that she has in her artwork. So there's probably some people that might have noticed, but there is like a piece where a self-portrait where Frida Kahlo is laying down in a desert, but she's like with a dress, and it's a similar position. So I basically like mimicked her position, but since the entire idea is around tamales and they're made out of corn, and my grandfather had a corn field in Honduras that they would like make their living off of with my mother. Mm-hmm. And just kind of that trickle effect of like that always being a narrative in my life, where it's like we hear about all these stories, and then be really integrated in like my household, even in Canada, just Honduran culture. So we wanted to tie all of that together into the cover, and the fact of me being like nude was really just last minute. I was just like, this makes a lot of sense. It's very like symbolic, but I was like very scared about it, but it ended up really beautiful. Like I was so happy. Yishuan treated it like so wonderfully, and I really love it personally.
But they're like, were you posing for it?
Yeah, no, well, okay. I was, Jeff, my manager, he took photos, but I wasn't like nude. It was just like, I was in like underwear, and then like Yishuan took the photo and he just painted from it.
Were you familiar with his work before that, or is that the first time you'd heard of him or met him or whatever?
First time. And cool. I don't know if I've seen his work, but it's like, it's so cool. Like it's so surreal. It makes me feel like, I don't know. It's like really dreamy. It makes me think of a bunch of different things.
And it looks like how your record sounds. That's why I like it so much.
Cool. Thank you.
I feel like I always forget to do that. Like I'm so good with like asking musicians for recommendations of different music and stuff, but I forget to do it with like other facets of art. Like someone who's a really good painter or something, I'm like, oh, who are like other good artists in that side of the world? And I think it's something that I should explore more, so hopefully.
Eric and Raul are a huge like reason why I even did that. Like I didn't even think about it. Like I've always having my work illustrated, and like for music, like getting somebody else to interpret what it might mean visually for them. But
no, it's great. I love it so much. Okay, and leading into that, so you're Honduran, but you're born in Canada, right? And then obviously the album is called Tamale, and then you have one called Gallo Pinto, which is another dish.
Yeah, it's that in Spanish, two L's are pronounced like a Y.
Just like pollo.
Yeah, like pollo.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yes.
Sorry.
No, it's all good.
are there any other Honduran dishes that are like lesser known that I should look into?
Oh man. Yeah, I mean, okay, once all this craziness is over, I think that Honduras has incredible scenery and food, and the staple dish for us is baleadas, which, I mean, I'll send you photos later on in the DMs, but like, it's like basically this, you know, naan bread, like Indian naan bread, kind of like that, but it's like stuffed with like beans, eggs, avocado, cream, feta cheese, and then you just like fold it up, and it's so good. It's so good. It's like a taco, but like better.
Like, but it's stuffed though, right?
Yeah, so it's like a tortilla laying flat.
Yeah,
and it's really warm and fluffy, and then you put all the stuff, and you fold it like a taco, and
you cook it once the stuff's inside, or do you cook everything beforehand and just put
everything's cooked beforehand? Yeah.
Okay.
And you just sweet.
That sounds so bomb. All right. What's it called again?
Baleadas.
I'm not even going to try. okay, so I really like your music videos as well. I can tell you, like, really put the effort into them, and I'm sure everyone appreciates that. Do you, like, what's your approach when you're going to do a video? How do you go about, like, coming up with the creative direction for it and stuff?
You're really good at this, by the way. You're good at this. asking questions. Okay, so my process. Well, I don't think I started to actually realize what music videos required as far as like effort and the amount of crew that you need sometimes.
Oh, it's insane.
Insane.
Like it's so stressful because you just need so much more budget, so it's so many more like moving parts, and I think people really like, if you see a good video, you should really appreciate it because it's so rare to just nail like all of those things. There's so many moving parts. So
then like even like just like off tangent, looking at movies now, when I like see them, I'm just yeah. like when there's a scene that I'm just like, wow, it's a crazy amount of budget for one scene.
For sure. But,
yeah, so I was really, really not in my element when I first did my official music video. What was it, like 4 years ago with Jeremy? Mm-hmm. And what I'm grateful for with Jeremy is that he's like really, really invested in getting to know the artist that he's working with. Mm. And that makes the project like really malleable from the beginning. Like you can just kind of brainstorm together and develop the idea. So I feel really lucky to have worked with him starting off on music videos, because now I feel like I understand more of just like when you're like building a pitch, putting a mood board together, thinking about like how to cast people, down to like producing and like thinking about budget and breaking it down and like what can you give up so that you can have something else. Yeah. So since I worked with Jeremy, now every time I write a song, I immediately think about a music video idea, which is like a very, yeah. Which
no, cool.
Frustrates my manager, because I'm just like, so it's going to look like this. Yeah. And he's just like, where's the budget?
Yeah. You're like, can you find like 60 grand? Cool.
Oh my God. I wish. That would be amazing. But yeah, I think that now I approach my stuff in my music in a different way, because I actually think it's so fun to make music videos. And I think that seeing more and more releases by artists, like I'm sure you can relate, but it's like you release a song on streaming services, and then if you have a visual aspect to it, it kind of like creates this entire world around like a single or a record. And I love, as even just as a listener and as a fan of other musicians like yourself, it's like being immersed in your worlds and other worlds is like my favorite thing. So
for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
I really like the video that we ended up doing for our song on my record.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. That was so special.
Yeah. Just like, I think we filmed it entirely on film, if people didn't know, and it turned out really nice. Yeah. So yeah. I'm really proud of that one. And like, yeah. I actually watched it the other day and I was like, this is great.
It's so nice to feel like that, right? You go back to like your work and you're like, I was really connected and I'm still connected to that.
Because like 70% of the stuff I look back from my past, I just cringe.
Yeah. Oh my God. I feel the same way. Like, I'm just like, why did I grow up on the internet so transparently?
But I kind of like, I like it too in a weird way. Because I think when I look back at things that are cringy to me, like I look back, like at least I was like trying stuff. And I think that's so hard. So I think everyone can take it with a grain of salt and like respect that you were just kind of like figuring out what works for you.
That's really true. That's a great way to put it. Because if it's one thing that I'm grateful for, is that all those years of like kind of just putting yourself out there on the internet for so long, you lose this fear of, I guess, just like doubting yourself too much.
Totally. Yeah. Well, I think you still doubt yourself. You just don't care as much.
Yeah, exactly. You just start losing.
You build up the callus.
True.
Do you think starting on YouTube like is the reason why you're like interested in the video aspect so much?
Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
I think that this whole like quarantine situation has kind of like, reignited all of that for me too. Mm-hmm. Because I started off doing things really DIY. And then moved on to like, you know, bigger crews and music videos. But now that I was about to go on like a world tour, so I was kind of ramping up for, you know, live shows, doing rehearsals with the band. And so my energy was like shifting a lot. And now that I have all this time to like create new music and just get, you know, better at producing, because that's kind of like a goal that I have for this year. And I'm just like, how can I make videos interesting again, but like with very minimal budget, like,
yeah,
you know, no money and no crew. So yeah, it's putting like a brand new kind of like fire inside of me to like figure that out and try and reignite my YouTube channel and like talk to my fans again in that way, because it's been a while. It's been a really long time since I've done
that. So maybe it's a blessing in disguise to like take you back to your roots.
I think so.
Sorry, I'm trying to like. Okay, so speaking of YouTube, do you remember what your first YouTube upload is?
Oh.
I did this to Lights because she has like a really like long music career as well.
Oh, yeah.
And was kind of like on the internet before it was kind of a thing yet in a weird way. And I feel like
the same way. Lights is like the OG.
Yeah, it's MySpace OG.
She paved the way.
Do you remember what your first upload is?
I want to say that it was 2015 Tara Naomi cover.
It's a Tara Naomi cover, but it's 2008.
Sorry, not 2015. Sorry, 2008. Yeah. Oh my God.
Do you know the song?
Say It's Possible.
Yeah. Damn. Good job.
Yeah. Thanks.
Do you want to play it on the back?
No.
No. You guys can look it up if you want.
Yeah.
We won't embarrass Daniela right now. It's good. It's good. It's just the quality is hilarious though.
Yeah. Oh my God. Like
just the audio quality is hilarious to me.
it's
But I love that. I love that. It's like fuck it. Like I'm just gonna put it up.
I don't understand. Like I would love to just go back and like see what my process was, but I just remember being so excited that my dad got this Fujifilm camera.
Yeah.
And like that concept of watching yourself back. I don't know if you remember a time without cell phones, you know, like without having like even a laptop where you could like watch yourself back with photo booth. I remember that was also an interesting feeling for me, but the first thing that I had was a camera, and then like I'd take the SD card out, put it in a computer, and if the take wasn't good enough, I'd like take it out, put it back in, and like redo it. And I was just like, it was such a long process compared to now, you know.
See, if only y'all knew the work that went into Say It's Possible.
So much work.
And then I was reading your Wikipedia before this, and I saw that your music has been synced in some different shows and commercials. What's the weirdest show or commercial that your music's been in?
I want to say that it's been in, like, I remember Jeff, my manager, telling me that it was, like, in Turkey or something, like, on some show in, like, Turkey.
A random Turkish television
show? Yeah, cool. And then I got like just like an influx of like new fans from Turkey and the algorithms, and I was like, "What's going on?" But that was the strangest one, I think, for me.
Yeah, I had like a song in like a German shoe commercial in like 2012 or something.
A German shoe commercial?
Yeah, like I don't remember what the brand was, but it wasn't like I don't think it was a cool brand. It was just like Payless shoes or something. But yeah, like all the comments now, like who's here from like, I don't know how to say shoe in German, but it's just funny.
That's so good. I want to see this commercial.
I don't even think I've ever seen it, actually. I just know it exists somewhere.
We're looking
it anyway, up. Anyway, I'll look it up after. We'll see if I can find it. Okay, so on my show, I don't do the top five. I do the bottom five because I want to know what you don't like. Ready for some controversy?
Okay.
You can do it, Daniela. I believe in you.
Wait. I have to say my bottom five things that I, what, like, I
don't like. I'm going to ask you things, and then you have to tell me your least favorite of that thing.
Okay.
Okay, what's your least favorite food? Is there a food that you can't eat?
Well, that's hard, because I actually, like, love all food. But if I were to say something that I just, like, I think eggplant is the one that's an on day or off day, and it's very like on a spectrum, like I don't feel it or I feel it.
That's a good one. I'm not a big fan of eggplant either. It's kind of hit or miss for me.
Yeah.
Although I've had like a pickled at like some sort of like Korean restaurants and stuff, and it's pretty good that way.
I think that's like my favorite way to have
Everything pickled is pretty good to me. It's like
true.
just kind of all taste the same then.
Yeah.
Do you have a least favorite clothing trend?
Oh man, the low riding jeans when I was a teenager were the death of me. Like, do you remember how low that shit got?
Like, yeah.
It was, for me, it was just like, the only reason that I feel conflicted about it is because I wanted them so bad. And I'm just, they're just so ingrained in my memory. And my mom was just so against them. She was like, absolutely no. So it's just this phase in my life where like, I was not able to wear something that I really wanted to wear. And looking back, I'm like, thank goodness that didn't happen.
That's so funny. Yeah, I remember like all those like Britney Spears, like Christina Aguilera era of like, yeah. Just crazy.
So good.
Okay, this is a hard one. Do you have a least favorite song?
Okay. So only my least favorite right now because I listened to it that much.
And it's just overplayed for you.
Just totally, it's The Box by Roddy.
Oh yeah, I probably couldn't even sing that right now. I'm okay. So bad with pop, it's embarrassing.
Yeah, it starts with the
oh yeah,
and it's like everyone was thrown down every time it came on, and I felt it so hard when it first came out, but then like now I just, if I hear it, I'm like, the rest of my day is just this entire song, so I can't hear it.
That's funny.
Yeah,
well, at least you had one. Most people can't answer that question, so I'm impressed. I'm very impressed right now.
Yeah, it's a tough one.
Is there an alcohol you can't drink? And is there a horrible story that goes with it?
Oh, 100%. I can't do whiskey at all. I black out. I forget. It's horrible. It's horrible.
No. Oh, man. I love whiskey. It's like one of my faves.
Great. I think we've had this conversation before, and I've been having like more and more mezcal lately just because after a trip to Mexico, a couple of trips to Mexico, I just like had a lot of mezcal and I didn't have hangovers, and I was like, what is this magical alcohol? And
yeah, I love mezcal. Yeah,
isn't it so good?
It's so good. You like that smoky flavor? Like,
oh, it's so good.
That's like so divisive for people. Like, either they love that or they absolutely hate that.
Which is the same for whiskey, I feel, because you develop a taste for like good whiskey, and I just can't seem to develop it as much as I try. I just end up getting to it doesn't take much either. It's like, I only need like two whiskey drinks to like make me completely sabotage my life. Like, I'm just like, who was I last night? Like, what is happening?
Two shots and you're done.
Well, I avoid it.
One guy keeps saying that we should collab, and we did already, and it's a song called Everyone But Me. So I'm just throwing that out there.
Yes.
Okay, do you have a least favorite interview question?
No, I think all of the interview questions I've gotten so far have been pretty good. I've never had an awkward one.
That's good.
Yeah. What about you? I want to know yours.
Mine is always just like, if you're in the city that you're playing that night for a show, they just say like, so how does our city compare to other cities? And it's always like a little bit awkward because like, obviously they want me to say the city is great, which it normally is, but like,
that's so awkward.
It's a very weird question. Because, like, what do you want me to say?
Because you literally, like, you step out of the airport and you're doing the gig. And, like,
I know.
What can you really say about
this? Well, and if you're, like, in a small city, you're, like, in, like, Hamilton, Ontario or something.
Oh.
I'm, like, I'm sorry, guys. Like, you guys are all nice here. And, like, I'm sure the party's fun. But, like, it's not New York.
Oh, my God. Have you ever answered...
Like, truthfully.
Yeah.
I think I, like, usually do it afterwards with the interviewer, but I will just, like, give them the answer. I don't know. Like, and for me, it's, like, it's so dependent on the party. Like, it really has nothing to do with the city. It's just, like, the show is so dependent. Like, I can play in an awesome city, and the show can be bad, and then the next time it could be great. So, it just, it's really, like, it's not really dependent on the city. It's dependent on the promoter and the crowd and stuff.
That's a really good point. So, so true, because my worst show was in Italy, but I'm not like trying to drag Italy at all. Amazing place to play.
Yeah.
But it was just, again, just like the night, like the day of the week that it is too, has so much to do with it as well. And when you're on a tour and you just like, having to play on whatever day it falls on, and it's just unfortunate.
Yeah, it happens. Yeah.
It happens.
Yeah, but it's not like a hate on the city. It's just, it is what it is.
It is what it is, for sure.
Okay, you want to hear some jokes?
Yeah. Let's do it.
Corona. We're doing Corona jokes.
You're ready. You're ready to go.
Are you ready for Corona jokes?
Oh, God.
Everyone's like, oh, God, no. Please don't make me laugh at something offensive. They're pretty tame, so don't stress too hard. Okay. If you get an email about canned ham contaminated with the coronavirus, you can just ignore it. It's spam.
Oh, my God.
So bad. So bad.
So bad.
Who gives me this joke? I need to fire my writing team. Okay. How do strippers ensure job continuity during the coronavirus crisis?
How?
They twerk from home.
Oh my God. That's like the dad joke.
They're all kind of dad jokes, to be fair.
So good.
Oh, we got some laughs in the chat. I think we got a couple fans there. All right, the last one.
Yes, people are laughing. Tell me.
All right, what do Ryan Gosling and the coronavirus have in common?
What?
They're both breathtaking.
Okay, that one was good.
That's pretty good.
I like that one.
I don't know. I like laughing. It's important to laugh.
Oh, yeah. No, it's great. It's so great.
Just don't punch down, and then we can laugh, you know? That's my vibe. Okay, you want to do some fan questions? I asked on my story some fan questions, and I wrote a bunch down. And there were lots of good ones. Your fans asked really good questions.
Sweet.
So good job, Daniela fans. Okay, from 360 Journey, if you could be reborn as any animal, what animal would you be and why? I like that question.
Okay, this is gonna sound like really, really cliche, but since I've gotten older, I don't know if you're like into horoscopes at all, but I'm a Leo, and I just always, for most of my life, rejected the fact that I was a Leo until I figured out that like my moon sign is Pisces. So I was like, oh, that makes sense. I'm like conflicted about all of this. But like, as I've gotten older, I've just been trying to like assume more of my Leo, because it actually makes me feel just better mentally. So I would probably say a lion. I'd like actually want to come back as like the full form of whatever.
That's good. That's great.
Yeah.
I just, like, I'm similar. Like, I want to be a cat because I feel like it would be nice to have no goals.
But actually, they're so, like, unapologetic. They're just, like, whatever.
It's great. Right? You got to earn the cat's love. I like that.
That's the thing, is that, like, I always thought that I wasn't a cat person, but I realized, like, I am a cat person. It's just, like, I'm way too needy, and they detect that in me, so I just need to like work on that, you know, just let them be.
Someone says with or, oh, is this the guy who asked the question, with or without,
with or without the mane? With the mane, you gotta have
almost got it going on right now.
Yeah. The craziest mane.
How much do you miss haircuts right now?
Dude, I'm like so grateful that I decided to like make my hair low maintenance, because I've just been keeping it really natural for the last 3 years, and I'm really feel like, how are you feeling without a barber?
Because I'm just getting very like, it's getting harder every day. It's kind of like, I'm getting like a fro. It's embarrassing.
Because your hair's like really thick too, right?
Yeah, and it gets curlier like the longer it gets, so it's gonna get worse and worse. It's all downhill.
You have curly hair?
It's like weird back curls. Like, it's not really curly, but it's like it gets a bit wavier, curlier as it goes. It's strange. I've never grown it out super far though, so we'll see what happens.
I think there should be like a petition for you to grow it out. I would love that. I would love to see that.
No. Okay, Cherokee Roses asks, how did you transition from doing covers to making your own music? Because she says she's struggling with that.
Okay.
Good question.
Really good question. Damn, that's like, that doesn't have like a super good short answer.
We got time.
What I will say is that for me, it just came up to a standstill. Like, I just stopped feeling good about doing covers. And so thankfully, I was able to listen to that inside myself and just be like, okay, I'm not feeling really happy about the content that I'm posting because I don't feel like it's pushing me necessarily to my ultimate goal, which has always been to like have my own, you know, full length record. But songwriting takes a lot of like introspection and like it's a process, you know, and I went through my phases of like approaching it from way too sacred of I felt like I needed to be in the right place at the right time to be inspired, you know, to write my own song. But what I've learned throughout the years is that consistency is key. So like just constantly songwriting and trying to figure out what I'm trying to say and how do I like my voice to inflect when I'm singing things that I want to sing about. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I finally reached that until Tamale, the last project, where I'm getting closer to the topics I want to talk about and how I want to record my vocals and stuff like that. So it's been like a 3-year process for me to break away from that habit of like just creating covers, because at first it was like my creative outlet, but then it became kind of like just something that I did. And now creating original music is like very therapeutic and creative outlet for me. So I think trusting that kind of pull that you feel, if you really feel a pull to like create your own music, just keep trying, like every day, try and write something. And like one thing that really helped me was like a Splice document that you can look up. It's like analyzing a song, and you just like pick a song that you really love and you listen to it. I think it's like you listen to it for a total of 2 hours, and you go through 4 different passes where you analyze why you like it sonically, lyrically, and it's supposed to help you like develop an ear for producing and like songwriting. And
that was on Splice.
Yeah, that's on Splice.
You should give me the link after, and I'll put it in the comments when we upload this to IGTV or whatever.
Yeah, I'll do that. That helped me a lot. So I did that for like a good 6 months, and I just took like a lot of the artists that I loved, and I broke down the songs, and I was like, okay, this is a lot easier to approach than I imagined, actually. So yeah, just keep trying. Yeah.
I have a follow-up question. When you were doing covers initially, were you doing that with the idea of knowing that you would switch to wanting to do originals, or are you just kind of like doing it because it was fun to start?
I think so. I think the latter. I think I just found it really fun to take a song and try and interpret it in my own way.
Yeah.
And that kind of gave me an introduction to Logic and GarageBand and then Logic and learning like different effects chains, and it got me curious about producing, but I was too intimidated by the thought of producing. And then I jumped to like going into studios afterwards and just realized like how all of that stuff, like doing covers, learning how to like record audio properly, learning how to sync things for videos, like editing my own videos with Jeff, sometimes my manager. It's like all of these little things that I picked up are being valuable to me now. So yeah, I'm super grateful.
It's like the Steve Jobs thing where he like took the, calligraphy class in school, and he like learned about fonts, and then he like applied that to like having the computer with fonts and stuff. So
exactly.
You pick up all these things along the way and then don't know how they're gonna play into the final formula. Just be interested in shit, guys.
Be curious.
Curious. That's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
Okay, Jared, not Jerry, said, by the way, that was a really great answer. So thank you for that insight. Jared, not Jerry, says he loved the Shore EP and wants to know what the backstory for it was.
Thank you, Jerry, not Jerry.
Thanks, Jerry.
Shore was like a compilation of songs that I'd written between the ages of 17 and like I want to say I was 20. So again, I was really trying to just exercise that songwriting muscle a bit more, but mostly it was focused on the guitar. So my chord structures were really only coming from my knowledge of the guitar, and I had no idea about like how to like recreate a song from guitar to like what I was doing with other people's songs of like taking like a fully produced song and stripping it down to acoustic. I didn't know how to do that for my own song. So Shore kind of came with that mentality. And so I wrote all these songs on the guitar and I brought them to a producer, and that's how it worked on the technical side. But as far as like the theme of it, just, I think I was always writing about, I think we all do. We all write about love and in some way or another, frustrations of it or like how you feel towards it. And it's like that. But I feel like the emotional approach was like, in my eyes now, it was very much about another person and not so much about myself. Like I was reflecting about like my relationships from an exterior point of view, but not really like looking inwards too much. So whenever I listen to that record, I'm like, oh my God, so cute. Like I was really just like, you know, puppy love with a bunch of people.
Do you like listening back to it now, or does it make you?
Oh God, no. Which I feel like might, but I mean, are you like that with some of your old stuff?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah. I derive all of my songs from personal experience. So I'm just like, when I listen back, I'm just like, wow, I can't do this right now. Like, I can't like think about this.
Yeah. It's like, how do I take this off? <Just
kidding>. Sometimes, right?
Sometimes, but not really. I don't actually feel that way, but I feel, yeah, it's like, there's a little bit of cringe for sure, but there's also like, it's like a, I have a love for my earlier stuff as well. It's just in a different way.
Exactly.
Yeah. Cheese and Eggs wants to know, which book are you reading right now? I guess if you are currently reading a book.
Mm-hmm. I'm reading Miami by Joan Didion. And then last night I started Simulation and Simulacra by Jean, I can't say his last name, Baudrillard?
Sounds right to me.
Apparently it inspired the Matrix.
Okay.
I've just been seeing a lot of people playing Animal Crossing and it's just freaking me fuck out. It's like, this is gonna further VR, this is gonna speed up the process. And if we have to quarantine even more, I'm just like obsessed with this thought of simulation. And I've had this book laying around, so finally cracked it open last night. Tripping me out, bro.
It freaks me out a little bit when I don't want to like start the like train of thought sometime.
Yeah.
Because even I was like walking home today from, I went to my studio for a little bit and I was just walking around. And I'm like, is this the new reality? Like, I don't want to have that thought.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's important to grasp onto whatever makes you feel good, you know?
Yeah.
And it's interesting to see everybody's different outlets, even through like Instagram, right? Like just people's coping thoughts, so like their meditation. Some other people are just like working out really hard and it's just like, oh, okay, that's your thing. That's awesome.
You know? Some people become alcoholics. That's cool.
did they close? I know in Ontario, they closed Lickbo. Did they close in Vancouver? Are you in Vancouver right now?
Yeah, I'm in Vancouver. No, all like the BC liquor stores are still open because they're actually like essential services in case you like actually are an alcoholic.
Right.
It's kind of like a weird, I don't know. I mean, that makes sense. If you would like, you don't want people just like going through crazy withdrawal when hospitals are already in a bad state, I guess. I don't really, but liquor stores are still open. So.
Okay. But, yeah. Drink responsibly, everybody.
My friend Alan, I'm an alcoholic. Alan, come on, chill out. Chill out in the comments, Alan. Okay, let's just do two more questions, and then okay. I think that is a good episode for the night. Leslie Curiel wants to know, lyrically speaking, who inspires you the most?
Mm. Okay, I think that answer always varies with who I'm listening to the most lately. And lately it's just been
Roddy Ricch.
Roddy Ricch. Just is going to be like a bunch of like, and all no, it's been like Frank Ocean, Erykah Badu, and Nick Hakim and Kim Krule. Those are the people I've kind of been listening to. I don't know if you do this thing where you ask yourself sometimes, really, when you're feeling really stuck, but sometimes when I'm trying to approach like a topic, I'm like, if I were listening to this and like wanting to hear back this topic, like how would this person approach it? Do you ever do that? Like,
picture somebody else writing about it?
Yeah.
I definitely have done that in sessions sometimes where I think of, you know, like if this was written as a Lana Del Rey song, like how would, because I feel like the way she does lyrics is quite like in her own way and uses like weird adjectives sometimes and a mix of modern and old and stuff. So I think it's definitely a way to like approach things, but I don't think I imagine an entire song, I guess, from that perspective.
Yeah, no, I think that's what I mean. It's like sometimes you're just like, how would, yeah, like how you put it is perfect.
I heard that's like what Ed Sheeran does. Like he just sits in a room and is like, well, what would a Rihanna song sound like? And then they just try to write an exact Rihanna song.
Right.
And a lot of the times though, it just ends up being his song.
Right.
Yeah.
No, that's what, I think it was what one of my friends, his name's Andrew from New York. He's a mixer. And he was telling me that in school, they would make them like reinterpret a song, and everyone would listen to the same song, and then they'd reinterpret it, and they'd come back and play the songs, and they all sounded like completely different songs.
I love that.
Like, I love that so much. So it's like, yeah, it's okay to be derivative sometimes and just like grab inspiration. So
that's so cool. Man, you want to know my craziest songwriting story I've heard? I wasn't a part of this, but. Yeah. When I was in Norway, some of them were writing for like a K-pop band, and they split, they had like 30 writers at this thing, and they split them into different rooms, and then they just gave everyone the same key. And then they just picked verses from one song and like chorus from another group, and then they just like pieced the whole thing together. Because everything.
Cool.
How cool is that?
That's so, and it also makes a lot of sense because when I listen to K-pop, I'm just like, what's going on?
I know.
But it's amazing though. Like, I love it.
It's such a cool experiment.
So cool.
Yeah. But awesome. Now I want to do that with like a bunch of producers or something.
Yeah. Imagine giving that a go. That would
maybe
be
I sick. Should.
You should do it.
The quarantine challenge, maybe.
Dude, that would be sick. I hope that actually happens.
All right. I'm writing it down. Okay. And the last question we'll do, from, I'm going to butcher this name, Fatira Manita, I think. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I probably butchered that. What are you doing to stay healthy, body and mind, during this time?
I'm not being too intense with myself. I think something that I tend to lean towards is I've been running a lot for a really long time, like many years, and I did like a full marathon and stuff, which kind of requires you to train really hard. And I think I've been trying to come down from that regimen since and realize that like working out and like being healthy is more of like a mind state than it actually is like from what it is physically. Like just because someone looks fit doesn't mean that they're like
completely
healthy, you know?
Yeah.
So just trying to keep the stress at a lower level than usual because it's already peaking because the world is so crazy.
What kind of things do you do to keep the stress at a lower level?
This sometimes.
Like drink responsibly.
Responsibly. Like not feeling bad for like having a glass here and there, even though it's like a Wednesday, you know what I mean? I typically, when the world was regular on a Friday, I'd be like, okay, I'll drink something. But I also like try and like move as much as I can, like walk, take some steps and do exercise every day, like 20 minutes, even 10 minutes, just get my heart pumping. And mostly just like taking it pretty easy, working on music because it keeps me sane. So I do that for a few hours a day for sure. And talking to my family a lot more than before, but it's bringing me a sense of calm too because I like to know that they're okay, which they are. So I'm glad.
Where do they live?
They're, half of them are in Edmonton and then the other half is in Ontario and some in Montreal. So. We're all over. Everyone's okay, so I'm glad.
Parents are good for keeping you grounded in these times, I think.
100%, yeah.
Yeah. Have you been FaceTiming people more?
So much more. I feel like I'm being like more social than I was on a regular basis.
Yeah, that's like my big joke, is that like since I have a producer, like, I've just been going, like, my whole life is basically just going to the studio by myself anyways.
Yeah.
And now people are just asking me how I am all of a sudden.
Right?
And I'm like, I've been doing this for 10 years. No one asked me how I was before.
That's so good. But it's also nice because you realize, like, how many people, like, genuinely, like, wonder about you, too. You're like, oh, that's so kind. Thank you.
For sure. Yeah, it's nice. But, well, I'm glad you're doing well.
Thanks.
I liked hearing about the tamale story, and I want to eat that food that I forget the name of.
Yeah, I'm going to send you a picture, like, ASAP.
Okay, sounds good. And send me the link for the splice thing, because I actually really want to check that out. And I'll post it later when I repost this video.
Okay.
But thanks so much for being on my show.
Thank you so much for having me. You're so good at this.
Well, it's my 7th episode, so I'm killing it.
Killing it.
Thanks, everyone in the chat.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks for everyone that sent in questions. And I hope you're being safe and don't drink too much. Cheers.
Cheers. Good night, guys.
Bye. See you later.